Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Mixtank on Puremix.com. Mixtank is like a think tank for your mixes where Puremix members upload their mixes to Mixtank and then get comments from the community. And I go live on Mondays to review the mixes and talk about it live. And then, of course, you guys join me in the chat, which is awesome. This show is very interactive, and the chat always has really good insights on the mixes as well. So make sure that you do pay attention to the chat as we go here. To start off, if you're here joining us and you have a mix that you'd like me to review today, let me know your username and the name of the track in the YouTube comments, and then I'll do my best to get to all of them before we get out of here. We try to prioritize the people who come to the live stream first for taking the time out of their day to be here and everything, so we'll get to those. Little bit of housekeeping stuff from Puremix. We have a new video coming out Friday with Jesse Ray Ernster mixing Doja Cat's Woman. It's super cool. Jesse has a really, really unique way of teaching and just demonstrating and explaining everything that he does. He's very articulate, and it's pretty awesome. You might know Jesse from some of the great big plugin shows I've done with plugins from Mixland Audio. That's his plugin company as well. And that's what he does in his spare time outside of mixing hit records. So that's pretty cool. Jesse's an awesome guy, super humble, and a really, really awesome on camera. So look out for that on Friday. It's Doja Cat Woman is the track, and it's super cool. So we'll have that up there. Good to see everybody in the chat here. Got a good crowd today. It's going to be fun. Awesome. Okay, let's go over to Mixtank. And here we are. So up first, I have a track from Super Rail. I'm probably doing a bad job of pronouncing that. But this is Mr. Emotional. This is How I Feel Inside. This is from a start to finish series that we did on Puremix. And you can download the multi-track on Puremix and check out the video and all that. He says in his comments, "Hello, fellow Puremixers. I think I'm done with the mixing. It feels very good to me. My opinion after several listens in different situations, and I'd like an overall statement about the feeling of the track. Is it engaging and emotionally impactful? Very well produced song, by the way. I had a lot of fun. Thanks all." All right, let's check it out. Here we go.
You said you love somebody else. I can't do a thing about it. I should only blame myself. Yeah, yeah. You said my dead, yeah. Just wanted you to know.
I'm gonna check two things real quick, so bear with me, hold on here. absolutely love the effect you put on the vocals coming out of this chorus. Let's all check it out real quick.
And I'm ready to die. You said you love some-
That is a awesome example of doing a tasteful effect on a vocal that doesn't pull you out of the song and say, listen to me, I'm a mixer. It's like blended into the track perfectly. It's creative and it differentiates the section and calls attention to the, you know, the whole like moment that's happening there. I was going to say the title of the song, but that's not the title of the song there. Just well done though. Very well done. One more thing I want to check. Hang on.
I got a heart-shaped hole coming.
Awesome. Nice lift going into the chorus, too. I like how you you pumped up the intensity and the level of it. I only have two comments on this whole thing. This is really, really well done. Great, great job. I'm very familiar with this track. This was produced by a friend of mine. His name is Angel Lopez. He's done all kinds of amazing things, and he's a dear friend. So I know this track very well, and I was wrong. Sorry, this is not from a start to finish, but this is from a mixing video that's available on the site, and I believe multiple people have mixed this on Puremix. So definitely check those videos out, and you can get the stems and everything. But so my only comments are the bottom end around like the, you know, around like 100 hertz, like maybe even a little lower, 80 to 100 or something, feels just a hair congested, but it also has a nice thick amount of girth on the bottom there. So always fun to try and explain low end, but yeah, it feels great there. It might have a little too much. And then the only other comment was on the vocal effects. I was hearing a lot of mids in there, like 300 to 400 hertz, that might be clouding things up when it gets a little bit more swimmy. That could possibly be dipped for some more clarity and focus on the lead vocal. The other thing that you could try with this is like side chaining the effect returns with a compressor to the lead vocal so that they dip a little bit while he's singing. Not so that it buries them and you don't hear the effects, but it just keeps a little bit of focus on the lead vocal. And honestly, those are super, super nitpicky things. The bottom end thing I feel like could be handled in mastering, and then the effect thing could honestly just be artistic interpretation. So great job. I really don't have much to say about this. Really well done. And I feel like with a great mastering engineer, this would be sitting really, really strong. So great, great job on that. Awesome. Brad Hex says girth is the word of the day. I'll see if I can pull out some other ones. All right. Nice. We got a lot of submissions in today. This is really exciting. Okay. Next one I'm going to pull up is from Studio Jaman, called Uplifting. And his name on YouTube is Mike Ornsby, and he was saying that it is Thanksgiving in Canada today. And he posted an awesome bit of text about music as a whole that you should scroll up and read. It's very inspiring. And I totally agree with it. What am I doing? Uplifting. There we go. Uplifting. I can type today. Let me know if I'm typing the wrong thing there, Mike. I'll try this again. We'll come back to it if it doesn't pop up now. Okay, we'll come back to it. I might have the wrong song title or something there too, but let me go on to the next one. Hey, we got Palisades. Let's just do this one right off the bat. I think I saw you in the chat too. Yep, there you are. Don't wanna. Here we go.
I'm not afraid to
have to interject. My Dante system for Atmos sometimes likes to make these sounds as well. So you and Dante have been collaborating. Okay, awesome sound design as always. Let me check one spot here, right after the Dante section. Okay, awesome. So on the arrangement front, so over in the comments you wrote, hold on, find my mouse. All right, you wrote, for this track, I really wanted to take a deep dive into creating complex sound design. While I approach sound design as a creative tool, I also want to make sure that my sound design from a mixing perspective is well-balanced. Additionally, I appreciate any suggestions on arrangement, especially the final build drop, which I'm still unsure of. There's still a few things I need to fix, plan on changing, but I'm hoping that this track is close to being finished. Thanks, everyone, for your help. Okay, so arrangement-wise, my only thought was coming out of this, what I call the Dante section, when the drop happens, having the lack of the one, I was expecting to hear the one, so it's cool that you don't do it there, and I'm sure that that's a technique in the genre and everything. I felt like I wanted it there to keep the pulse going, but that's totally up to interpretation. So on the mixing front, this track is feeling really good, I think. So I'm feeling like the sound design stuff, compared to other mixes that you've submitted on here, the sound design stuff is more balanced and a part of the entire track and a part of the groove, which is super cool. It's not totally distracting me and pulling me away from the core element of what's happening in the rhythm. The electric guitars felt like they could have a little bit too much bite around 3K. I would check that on some earbuds and just see if they're grating to you or not, and listen for anything else that might be just kind of grating or irritating. And you don't want to dull that stuff to the point where it's not exciting anymore. I totally get that, but it might just be a little bit heavy in that area. So yeah, otherwise I don't really have anything for this one. Great job. Thanks so much for submitting another one. Great to see you today. I had my strobe lights ready, but I got distracted by Dante talk. So, okay. Our next one is going to be from Jose A. The song is called Pitten. Let's see. Just type in Pitten. There we go. All right. Pop on HD. And here we go. Thank you. awesome. What a cool piece of music. It was just a reminder, like, how cool it is to get here, sit here and listen to music for the next couple hours. And yeah, it's great stuff. Always, always amazed at all the stuff that comes on here. Okay, so just a couple of thoughts on it. I think that you've done an exceptional job of the balance. Everything just feels really, really good. The percussion's right where it needs to be for the genre and all that, and the horns, the mid-range feels really, really good. I'm going to echo what Tom said below here, which is two things. So he said, feels a little stiff to me. My urge is to use more reverb to give it a better sense of depth. And then the other one was he was missing some sub. So I would agree with both those statements. And first off, to chat about the sub stuff, there's not a whole lot of instruments giving that energy there, just the upright, I believe, but it does feel like everything, like there's not a whole lot happening under like 100, you know, just down in the bottom. And it, just having a little bit of that, I feel like would balance out some of the mid-range presence of the horns, which is great. And you don't need to like duck that or anything. It just feels like it could use a little bit of weight or girth, as we said earlier for the word of the day, down on the bottom. So, yeah, it might be something to check out. Just see what instruments might have some energy down there and see if you can bring it up a little bit. Obviously, you'd look at the bass first for that. And then regarding the sense of space, so a lot of the horns are all in mono and a lot of the elements are in mono. For things like the horns, you could try using a room simulator, Universal Audio's, Oceanway Studios, so good. I don't want to go back to life without that plugin. But there's other ones as well. If you're in the T-Rex suite of plugins, the Sunset Sound, Room Verbs are great. They have one, I believe, for Fame Studios or, yeah, I think it's Fame. And yeah, anything like that will be useful. But specifically, Sunset Sound, Oceanway are my favorites, and that Fame one is pretty cool too. And it's not to make them swim in reverb, it's just to add a space that they exist inside of, because right now it sounds like direct mics. The piano to me felt a little bit like it does have some sense of space on it, but it also feels like it might have some phase issues. It feels super wide to me, which wide is okay, but it felt a little bit thin and distant. So one thing that might be good to check out, if you have Sound Radix Auto Align or Auto Align 2, just check the phase coherency between the left and right there and see if running something like that will tighten it up. You could also just check by inverting the polarity on one of the channels. And then the other one, Little Labs IBP, is good to check that out. I think Waves has something called In Phase that could be used for it. But just see if there's any phase discrepancy going on between those two. Another great way to check is if you just sum the mono and see if it cancels out. I didn't think to do that while I was listening, but that would be a good check. The space thing and then just a little bit of low end, and I think that you're in a great space on this, just like those horns will be if you do that. So awesome, great job, thank you so much for submitting that. Fantastic musicians too, geez. Okay, so next one is going to be from Aku Fen. Let's see here. So Aku, there he is. So this is Neptune-C-Star, and he says, hey, here's the second version of this mix. Thanks again for the feedbacks on the first one. Help me out. I tried to include them. I hope this version has a more lively lead vocal. Thanks for writing your thoughts and listening. Okay, cool. Here we go.
Through the rain, the misty island fell into the sea. Dark clouds battle, lighted springtime, change the clock in me. Drifting backwards, I was falling, time was never here. Headlands fading, colors shifting, horizons disappear. All the loves I gazed upon, all of them gone. Strange things I have laughter said, sing within my mind. Waterproof the pages missing, story folds and rhyme. My lifeboat lost, I am alone. Time was never here. Stolen words and broken kisses, nothing left to fear.
Great song. That's super cool. Yeah, the pulse feels really, really good. Just as Brad says in here, he says, I was swinging in and out of my chair listening to this. The pulse throughout the song feels great. And the reason I stopped and replayed that section was the first time you go into those breaks, it felt like you rushed the hit just a hair, like ever so slightly right here. Doesn't grab my ear as much when I play it back this time, so could have been me. Maybe I was swaying out of time, but yeah, I thought that there might be something to look at. It could be either in the band hitting or in the rhythm of the vocal, but it didn't bother me that time, so maybe just disregard that. Check it one more time, and if it's good to you, it's good. The thing I heard at the beginning, let me go back to the top here, and I just want to check something.
Drifting back.
So there's some really cool guitar elements happening in here.
To the sea, light it, springtime, change the clock in me.
So the acoustic guitar that's doing the arpeggiated part on the right side, that guy feels really loud to me, and especially as the song progresses, as Brad says, it kind of feels like it leans left heavy because there's more stuff happening in the arrangement on the left. In the beginning, it's leaning right heavy for me because that acoustic is so loud. And I feel like it's covering up some of the really cool guitar tones and effects and stuff that you have happening on this part in the break before that guitar drops out. So that was one of my only things, is just automation throughout the song, I think, just to like bring out some more of those moments. And it's definitely, I think Tom said this below, or maybe that was on the last one. Yeah, what he said at the end here, it's always good when things come together in a way that you can zoom out and enjoy the music rather than scrutinizing details too much. Absolutely where this is at. So I think like just going through doing one more automation pass and just asking like, is the focus where I want it to be? Is the spotlight on the right element at this moment? In the beginning, that acoustic guitar arpeggiated part was the highlight in the mix to me. It was louder than the vocal and just drawing a lot of attention to itself. I also agree about Tom's comment on the 200 to 300 buildup in the cajon. I think that there might be some of that in the bass too, but it could just be that when they're both hitting, there's like a little bit of a resonance that's causing, you know, some masking there and just kind of a buildup in an overtone somewhere in that area. So I would check that out as well, because I think if you solve anything that's going on there, it's going to add some clarity to it. But it's not a huge issue either. I was kind of wishing for a little bit more sub on this one as well, just something in the bottom. I don't know if the cajon has anything down there that you can lift up, but maybe just a little bit more low-end support. No, Brad, I'm not going to use the word again. And the last thing was on the vocal. I hear a little bit of a distortion up pretty high. I couldn't tell you where it is. I want it. My brain says 8K, but it's probably not there. But let's just listen to the vocal a little bit over here. So there's just a little bit of a buzz in the top end of the vocal, and sometimes that stuff is just not going to go away. It could be in the singer's voice, it could be the preamp, it could be all kinds of things. It doesn't sound awful, and it adds a bit of presence to the vocal, so it might be cool to just not worry about it. It's something I would investigate with EQ and just see if, like, dipping some of that, if I could get rid of some of the buzzing, but it's being super picky at that point, so I wouldn't worry too much about it. Maybe just give it a once over with an EQ, and if you get something that you like better, great. If it takes away the presence, then don't worry about it. Cool. Thank you so much for submitting. That was a fun listen. Okay, let's go to BK Rudel. This is Divide by Two. Okay, and in the comments he says, bedroom studio recordings, artist is Terry Mutter, just looking for overall mix review, maybe focusing on low end and overall balance. Thanks for listening and looking forward to feedback. Here we go.
Nothing new. Evil minds divide the world by two. Convince the masses someone's taken from you. And there's nothing that you can do. But you're a lot like me, and I'm a lot like you. Shattered, battered, black and blue. When did our difference become?
I'm going to pause there just to point something out, because you hear it really well on the break. The drum reverb is a little bit long in what I would call like a non-musical way. So, a lot of times a cool trick with reverb is to make sure that it's the decay time is timed to the music. So potentially a cool way to get something grooving is you can have reverb on it, but have the decay be so tight that maybe it's gone by the next downbeat or the next quarter beat or something that just feels like it helps the pulse of the song. This one has almost like a hall sound or a chamber. It's like kind of a bright reverb sound that's kind of tailing over the next transient. So instead of like breathing with the track, it's just kind of creating a little bit of a soup in there. And you can kind of hear the length of that decay when the drums hit the break here. So check that out as we're going, and let's move and listen.
Black and blue. Shattered, battered, black and blue.
I also hear the hi-hat splashing in that reverb a little bit, which is causing like another rhythmic note to happen. So you can, two ways of dealing with that. It's been dubbed the Abbey Road trick, to throw an EQ before the reverb and take out some high-end, or you could work on the high-end diffusion of the actual reverb, depending on what one you're using.
When did our difference become our fear? Why is the difference all we hear? A rhyme, a reason, light a fire, take control. Make people fear what they don't know.
Very nice. Awesome. I always enjoy your stuff when you upload it. You work on a lot of really cool music. And I always, you say bedroom studio recordings. I imagine that you're in a lake house by your profile picture, just making awesome music all the time. So very cool song. So last two things to point out, aside from the drum reverb thing for me, the vocal effects as well. I'm hearing them come up, and I'm also hearing a lot of compression and excitement in the mix, just from kind of being a little bit too smashed. I'm not sure if it's just the vocal bus, but I think I'm kind of hearing it everywhere, which is causing some of that drum reverb to come up and kind of get cloudy. It doesn't feel like there's a lot of top to bottom depth, if you will. Brad, you can come up with a word for that. We won't use girth for that one. But Just hearing a lot of like low end stuff, like the reverb stuff, all come up. Not low end frequency, but low volume stuff. And then the vocal feels pretty overcompressed to me. However, the last section kind of made sense why that might have happened, which is here.
Black and blue. Black and blue.
So on blue, it feels really cool. You have all that proximity effect and bottom end from the voice. And I actually hear a lot of sub rattling going on, like it's not high pass there. So right here.
Black and blue. Black and blue.
It sounds to me like that's AC noise or wind noise that's happening across the mic capsule. It's very, very quiet, and you would need full range speakers to hear it. But I'm hearing that in there, and that's going to eat a lot of your headroom, especially if you're pushing this in to heavy compression or something. So try a high pass on the vocal. And if you want to get that close up, like he's singing right in your ear sound at the end there, you could always automate the compressor to go to that level at the end and then let it breathe a little bit more throughout the rest of the track. You can also hear the noise of the room go away here.
Black and blue.
So you kind of hear all that air come up as the compressor lets go, and then it cuts off with your vocal edit on the waveform. But listen for that one more time. So just listen to the room noise come up and level.
Black and blue.
Yeah, so releasing some of the compression might help out with the vocal effects. If you want to keep them up at that level and keep the compression and everything where it is, if it feels good for you for the energy, you could try doing what I mentioned about side chaining the effects to the lead vocal, where you're not smashing them, but just a dB or, you know, two or whatever feels good of compression. When the lead vocal sings, it can just push down the reverb returns, and then as, you know, he backs off, you can let the level come back up. I don't do that to a point that it's a noticeable thing. It just adds a little bit of clarity to the vocal, because you're taking all this reverberant information and just saying like, hey, chill out while he's singing, so that we can focus on him and have him be nice and tight and close, and then bringing it back up when he's done, so you still have the sense of space. Hopefully that makes sense. Awesome. Thank you so much for submitting. Always fun when you do. Okay, Keith Warman is our next one. Great Are You Lord. Here we go. So Keith Warman. Here we go. Click on my HD button. It says, please enjoy this new production complete with full band and string section. This time, it's our take on a well-known gospel song. Thanks, Tomfoolery and others, for all your awesome feedback. Lead vocal by Jason L. All right, Jason, let's hear it. Hear that lead vocal. Okay. Brad's word was shimmer. Nice.
You give life. You are love. You bring light into the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, and we pour.
Guys, I have a bad joke that I can't resist making. Keith, ignore me. So check this out right here. Right before the word, it's your breath.
In our lungs, and we pour out our breath.
So the clave sound, clave? I can see them in my head, but I can't think of the right word. But anyway, it sounds like the predator to me. So it sounds like you're saying the breath in our lungs, and then you hear the predator chatter sound. If you've never seen the movie, it's not going to make any sense. Let's listen to the song, shall we?
Great are you, Lord. You give life, you
Just going to comment on this while we're here. Beautiful string arrangement here. I'm feeling like it's overtaking the vocal just a little bit. Could be an EQ thing. I feel like it's a little bit of both, balance and EQ. They seem just a little bit loud and on top of the vocal. Beautiful again, though, so I understand why you'd want to emphasize them, but we'll just listen to half of that section again and just think about that. Here we go. Super cool with the piano at the end there, doing the low note scrape. That's awesome. Great job. It's a really cool take on that song. Oops, sorry. So my main comment is the strings just taking over the vocal a little bit. The other thing I was listening at was the relationship of the kick and bass. I felt like I wanted some more center punch and power from the bass, or from the kick drum and the bass a little bit. And it felt like it was just a little bit diffused in the center, and it wasn't giving me that like transient smack that I was looking for to match the really great snare tone that you got. So the other thing I was kind of hearing was a bit of stereo widening, and I could be wrong on this because it's not super overcooked with stereo widening, but I felt like I was hearing some like phase smearing stuff happening. And that's usually one of the first things that goes if you're using stereo widening like that and it's not a great widener. The center punch and power just kind of starts to get smeary, and that's due to like phase tricks that are happening from stereo widening stuff. So there was a little bit of that happening for me. The big note of the vocal, I felt like it was pulled back a hair too much. Like I wanted that to be this big moment, and the strings kind of came in and overtook it, I think, and it was pulled back in volume. I'm kind of going off of memory there. It was around here. Let me just see if I can find it. And we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. And we pour out our praise to you, oh yeah. Yeah, it might have been earlier, but yeah, the strings even there too. So going back to the bass and center punch thing, I checked this in mono as I was going to see about the stereo widening thing. And if you sum this to mono and listen to it, you kind of hear the bass overtake the kick a little bit. So just a little bit of work on the bass, guitar, kick drum relationship, I think could go a long way and just help you get some of the transients back in there. Yeah, so that, the string level, and then maybe just take a look at the vocal compression, make sure it's still like breathing okay and it's not being squished up. But otherwise, I think you're in a pretty good spot. You could check all of those things with the strings muted first, make sure the bed feels great, and then bring those strings back in. One thing I love doing too is, you know, if you need to rebalance something, just take the fader, bring it all the way down to zero. You could do a save as, so, you know, you're never going to lose anything. bring it all the way down to zero, listen at low volume, bring the fader back up until it feels right and it's not overtaking other instruments. I feel like a quick fader check on the strings there would do some service to this. If you already have automation on the strings and your DAW has it, use trim mode and you can preserve the volume envelope that you have throughout the song, but just adjust the overall gain up or down without having to do it from a plugin or something. So cool. I hope that that helps. Thank you so much for submitting that. Very cool. Next one is going to be Yes We Can by the Bone Daddies. All right. Let's see. Yes We Can. From Jeff Kleiser. And he says, this track by the Bone Daddies was recorded at Under the Sign Studios in Hollywood by Casper Abbas, who also supervised the mix. The Bone Daddies will check a few more songs up there for their new album coming out early next year. Awesome. Here we go. I love the length on that kick drum. Check this out. The very like bottom sub stuff is awesome. Couple things in this section here. The percussive sound is the loudest thing, which isn't necessarily bad, but I'm hearing horns and guitar and a little guitar-lick thing as well happening all on top of each other in the stereo field. So like they're all kind of just panned on top of each other. So let's listen for that. Here we go. Yeah, so this could be another use case for a room simulator, Oceanway, T-Rex, Sunset Sound, whatever. The horns are very mono, and while that is a cool effect in itself, maybe you want to leave it that way, but using the remic feature of one of those plugins where you're not going for a room reverb thing, you're just trying to add space and depth around side of the source, that could be really cool on the horns. Another thing to watch for, vocal compression. The vocal is nice and held down and tight and in place, and I wouldn't call it overcompressed. It's not breathing a lot, which is kind of okay, but I am hearing the consonants on the slap echo that you have on the sides come out and be a little bit distracting. They're adding a nice stereo effect to the vocal, and I totally dig that and love doing that. But I'm hearing some of like the T and like more like 4K, 5K sounds, even up to 10, just kind of coming out on the sides as like little percussive elements. So maybe a little bit of rounding off on the top end of that slap, or just bringing it back in the mix a little bit would help emphasize the vocal, not take away the effect that you have, but not call attention to itself either. All personal preference. What am I doing? Here we go. Yes, we can. No, we can't. Yes, we can. Why can't we if we want the yes, we can. I was also hoping to hear a little bit more punch from the kick drum, but I love the compression that you have going on where it's just kind of extending the note length of that thing, and we're hearing the nice sustain of that drum. So it could be a thing where you do a parallel, and even if you use like a two ways you could go about it, like a 160 will usually give you some of that attack before it does something. Or you could do a duplicate of the kick track and use a transient designer, boost up the attack, take down some of the sustain just so you get the punch, and then blend that in with your awesome kick that you have going right now in parallel. And that could be pretty neat. Yeah, the whole track feels awesome overall, and what a great band. The pocket on that is insane. So very cool. Good luck with the rest of the record. That's really good stuff. I hope that was useful. All right, let's see, we got Palisades already. I think Primetime is next. Let's see. Good to see you on here, Primetime. Milan. Yeah, cool, I got it. All right, here we go. From the top, he says, "Hello, mix lovers." There we are again. This is the most challenging mix I've ever done. Thanks to your good comments and trained ears, I'm pointed in the right direction. I'm convinced that... you can only mix the guitar as well if you know the story behind the arrangement. I'm not yet satisfied with the energy distribution, especially after the wrap. All right, let's check it out. Here we go.
Hello.
Okay, really, really cool. I just want to talk for 1 second here on this. So these guitars are ultra compressed to me, and they're so dense as a result that when you put them on top of your drums and the bass that are happening in there, the electronic components, they're completely masking it to me. Instead of feeling like the drums are poking through, it's almost like the guitar is so heavy that it is just kind of like this blanket that's sitting on top of everybody, but it's like the thickest blanket ever, where even though they're under there, you don't see a bump in the blanket or something like that. So I think if you could loosen the compression on the acoustic and let it breathe a little bit more, it would allow the rest of the mix to kind of come up into it as well. Here we go. Also, there's a bit of a buildup in one of the low mid notes on the acoustic and the bass that you have going on. They're both hitting same frequency, and it's just kind of causing an overtone to happen in that one area. I don't know the note that it's happening on, but you could, you know, if you have like Pro Q3 or something with an analyzer, you could have them both up next to each other or overlay the analyzers if you can. And I think that you'll see them both kind of bunch up in an area on there, and cleaning some of that up might help some of the clarity too. Here we go. Yeah, I kind of want to hear all the cool electronic elements that you have going on in this section, but I feel like I'm almost listening to two different things because the acoustics are so on top of it. Mostly just that bass. I want to hear it kind of wrap around those guitars. That's a super cool sound.
Direta pintando esse mundo novo, minha milonga não fala de adaga e espora, nem glorias, vitórias que aconteceram em combate. Ela fala dos meus, do presente, dos que lutam diariamente para garantir seus mates. Pois eu só canto o que pra mim é verdade e faz parte da realidade dos latino-americanos. Sem ser vaidoso, sem criar idolatria e viver a fantasia de que somos soberanos. E a milonga não precisa ter história, nem trazer a memória de algum pago ancestral. Ela é a cultura que anda sempre.
Okay, so the vocal has a whole lot of low mid in it, and not a lot of presence going on, so it's like 160 to 200 ish is where I'd start looking for some buildup. But it's a lot of proximity from the rapper being just super close to the mic, and it's a little bit muffled sounding. So two things you could do: clean up the bottom of it, and then I would do parallel compression on this. Take a squashed version of this vocal and blend it in parallel with the one that you have, and that should help the rap vocal to kind of like come forward in the speakers, right into the center and be a focal point here. The low buildup that's happening from it and the low mids and everything from the proximity is causing it to just kind of swim and get lost in the track there. Here we go.
Movimento e que traz no pensamento a sua opinião atual. Minha milonga se defende verbalmente, traz o intelecto a semente, cada qual com seu valor. Onde a igualdade desconhece o prepotente, faz com que a nossa gente só saiba cantar com.
Yeah, and just boosting top end on that would just be like sibilant stuff. It won't help bring clarity to it. So the diction of it, like how intelligible the words are, that needs to come up, and that's going to be in that like 1 to 3K range, just some more emphasis on the actual consonants and sounds of the words. But high end is just going to be the S's and T's and all that stuff too. So, don't think of the high end for clarity in this case. Those guitars are just beautiful. The playing is amazing on that. Very cool. Okay, so I can see why this would be a challenging mix. I'm going to recommend the same thing that I did on one of the previous ones, where do a save as and take the fader for the acoustic guitars, bring it all the way down to zero, keep your speakers down at a low volume, like, you know, 65, 70 or something like that, and slowly bring the acoustics up into the picture. And as you do that, listen to the things that you love. So first, with that fader down, identify the elements of the mix that you love and that you feel like should have the spotlight on them. And then slowly start bringing that acoustic up to a level that feels good, and listen in context with the things that you loved and see if it's masking them or not. I think like releasing the compression a bit on them and then doing a little bit of rebalancing will help it blend into that track, which, by the way, you have some amazing production stuff going on. And I love the bass sound that's happening. I love the stereo movement of it. All that stuff is really, really cool. It's just all kind of being hidden by the acoustic guitar, which is beautiful, but the rest of the track deserves to be heard too. It's really good stuff. So, and hope that helps with the rap vocal. Cool. All right, moving on. Good to see you again, Primetime. Thanks for being here. Okay, Nick Boosie, Deep Down. Here we go. So Nick Boosie. All right, From the Top.
Another all-nighter, another day after, I get stuck in my fantasies.
I'm gonna stop there. The snare drum, I feel like there's a pretty good buildup in like the 300 to 500 range that's just kind of causing a little bit of a blanket on the snare, and it's bringing up some of that stuff when the vocal and the snare are hitting at the same time. There's some buildup happening between the two of those and causing a mask. Just wanted to say that while we listen. Here we go.
Another November, and I still wonder what I should do now. Why in the world did I stop to sleep? Open my eyes and give up my dreams. Never thought of an end like this. Now I see that it ends like this. I look at the windshield of a downtown bus. Don't know where it's going, don't know where I am, and the rain starts to pour now.
Total creative decision, but I really like those background vocals, and I'd like to hear them up kind of rapping around the lead vocal. I think that'd be fun.
Running fast down the school class. I'm going down. Deep down, deep down. Deep down.
Gonna listen to something real quick. Cool.
In the midst of my memory.
rears. I look out the window of a downtown pub. Don't know where it's going, don't know where I am, and the sand starts to fall now. Running fast down this cold glass, I'm going down. Deep down, deep down, deep down. I'm going down. Deep down, deep down.
Little bit of a vocal timing thing right there. Just could maybe slide some of the words around and pocket it.
Deep down.
Awesome. So the that last synth line that's happening there, watch out for spreading it too far. Summing down to mono, it goes away pretty significantly, not completely, but definitely goes down, and it felt like it was just wrapping around my head in that weird way. Can be a taste thing. I talk about stereo wideners a lot, and I'm not a huge fan of them. But yeah, that when it starts feeling phasey and like it's canceling, it takes me out of the song, and just feels, in one way, it's cool because it's kind of like floating outside of the speakers, but it doesn't feel natural, and it feels like it's wrapping around my head in a funny way. I can't explain it much more than that, but it definitely will cause translation problems too, as you go to other systems. The only thing I have from a production standpoint, besides the other things I mentioned, just the snare sound, I wonder if it would be cool. Part of the awesomeness of this is that it's not a different snare sound from section to section, and that it's kind of minimalistic, and like I had this drum machine or these drum sounds to work with, and that's what it has. But there might be some things you could do just with automation, you know, to kind of change the power of the drums in certain spots, or maybe differentiate the snare sound a little bit, even if it's a snare or the same snare sound, and you just bring it down and level a little bit, or do a little bit of an EQ change in different sections, would just possibly add some different scene changes throughout, you know, from verse to chorus and stuff like that. But I love this song. This is super cool, and great job on it. It's feeling really good. I definitely think that you're close, as you said in there. So hope that helps, Nick. And I'd love to hear this when it's done. Awesome. All right. The vibe was super cool on that. Chat liked it a lot as well. Okay. Let's see. So I think our next one is from Mike Ornsby. And while I'm listening to this one, if I've missed your song so far, please drop it in the chat with your username for me. So this next one is going to be Medicine Dance. And here we go. Mike says, in honor of Indigenous Peoples Day in the USA, something new, bending some genres plus some mixing techniques while trying to blend both genres and mixing techniques to create a musical journey. Hope you like. Awesome. Thank you. Okay, this is definitely a journey. Holy crap, Mike. All right, let's see this section here. Cool. The low hit that happened there on the downbeat felt like it jumped out a little bit. I was expecting the kick to be that powerful on the next hit. Instead of feeling like a sub drop, it just stood out like a kick drum that felt weird. But I'm going to comment up to here so far. Let me go back just a second. Just watch out for low end rumble there. That was all beautiful. The section that comes in here. Maybe a little bit of a high pass filter on that bass drum that's happening just to help out with a little bit of the low rumble, but the low rumble is definitely part of the awesomeness. So just to kind of help clean the subs up, but not to take away from the amazing low end bloom that's happening there. And then the low mids of the guitars are pretty chunky, pretty beefy, and the bass guitar as well, all adding a little bit of cloudiness, I feel, that's taking away from the articulation of the guitar to help really emphasize that it's going along with the chanting that's happening. This is super cool. Let me go back to where I think I was. And I feel like we're about to change genre again. Mike, that is crazy fun. That's really, really fun. Hopefully you're still with us here. We got people asking what language the comments are in. Just awesome. Mike, that's a great piece. I'm guessing that the chant vocals were a field recording and then you guys wrote on top of it. I could be wrong, but that's what it sounds like to me, and it sounds super cool. I think just like cleaning up the bottom, the low mids, like I said, looking for a little bit of punch from the kick, watching out for the sub hit on the ultra low stuff, and you're in great shape. It felt really cool. The energy of it's great. And yeah, I feel honestly like where it's at, you totally get the point across anyway. So, take all of that as you will. Okay. Thank you so much for submitting that. It's always a musical journey when you do that. So very cool. Yeah, Dave Westner says the music's super awesome today. It absolutely is. Everybody's killing it. Okay, I think that our next one is going to be All Night by Kwasti Kwasti. If I'm saying that right. All Night. Okay, here we go. Gonna give you my first impression thoughts here. The bottom end of this track is actually really, really good, but it's quiet and fits the genre too. But if this is the low, let's see, how's the camera facing here? Yeah, let's call this my elbow the low end and this the top end. I could just say it's slanted, right? But it feels a little bit tilted like this. So the top end is just in the balance. It feels like the whole mix went like this. But the bottom is super well-defined, and I could tell that by cranking it up and listening to what was happening down there. Fortunately, it makes everything else too loud, but I'm interested in what would happen if you had this at low level and then brought up some of the lower elements a little bit. The balance overall feels really good. It just feels like there's that like tilt shelf EQ kind of thing happening on it. And then the only other thing was there's a little bit of like low mid cloudy stuff happening in the bass. Sometimes that can be like 160-ish just as a place to start looking, but somewhere in the low mids there. It's not bass. It's not the fundamental of the notes. It's some of the overtones that are happening, like the second overtone or somewhere in there. Just see if you can clean up some of that for a little bit more definition on it. Here we go. Brad says that you need to give your bass player a raise, Michael Quast. I don't know how Brad got this information, but he found out what you're paying the bass player. It's not enough. He's right. Listening to this track and not even knowing what you paid him, it's not enough. So here we go. There might be a little bit of sub rumble in the bass that's also clouding up some of the kick drum as well. So you might take a look at the super bottom of the bass and the kick and just see if they're playing nice together, if one's kind of covering the other guy up. Tons of techniques for that. You can, you know, sidechain the bass to the kick if you want the kick to push through a little bit more, or vice versa if you don't want the kick to come out outside of the bass. Multi-band compression, again, with side-chaining can be useful, or just a straight-up EQ move, subtle, can just make room for both of them, and that's the one that you should probably start with. But yeah, you could shave off a little bit of the bottom of the bass, though, and then you might not have to pay him as much because you wouldn't be using all the frequencies. Here we go. Our low end got stronger.
see here.
Awesome. Yeah, super cool. I think it got cut off at the end there, but yeah, that's amazing. Great playing and everything. Give the bass player a raise. You should probably give everybody in the band a raise because they're all amazing musicians. Only other thing I heard was the synth pad felt like they had some stereo widening on them again. My radar is going off for the phasey stuff that can happen from that. And then the reverb that's happening on multiple instruments, but specifically the pad felt a little bit long and like it was clouding things up to me. Might try just taking some low mid out of the verb or shortening the decay. But if you lose the spaciousness that you were, after, then what you had was good. Hope that helps. And great job. That's super cool. For the finding the kick in the bass thing, I would recommend just like soloing the drums and the bass and seeing if any of the moves that you make those notes feel punchier and tighten the pocket of the groove. That's ultimately what we're supposed to be doing, right? Is enhancing what's there in the music, not looking for how do I get perfect kick and bass separation and all of that. It's okay, what is the pocket? We need a super strong, kick doing the one, like the quarter note pulse and the bass supporting it and all of that. So if you can clear up a mask, does that make that beat feel like it's going with the groove better? Didn't say that very well, but basically it's all about the music, not about the, is this thing masking this and is that perfect? Okay. Also sounds like such an obvious thing to say, but okay. That was All Night by Quasi Quasi. Next one is Halloween Cannibal Humanoid. Awesome. Going with the theme of the month here. So Halloween, cannibal, not the day necessarily, but okay, here we go. From Smoking Fudo, good to see you. Says, hi everybody, quick idea made for Halloween. Wanted to give it a bit of 80s synth pop vibes. Ooh, my favorite. I like the drums, but probably there are a lot of transients compared to the rest. Then everything seems not too clear. Thanks very much. Cheers, Mirko. All right, let's check it out. High def for Mirko.
We'll be right back.
Apparently, I've got taken to the Power Station Tour at Berkeley NYC video, which just came out last Friday on Puremix. This feels like an ad inserted right in the middle of the stream by our own site. There you go. Let's go back to Mixtank and see what's going on there. So this track is super cool, Mirko. What was the name of it again? Halloween Cannibal Humanoid. Halloween Cannibal Humanoid. Cool. We were over here. I'm going to hit play again. Sheesh. Talk about interruptive advertising, you know? Here we go. Great track. Really great track. So I agree with everything that Brad and Tom Fullery said on this, which was Brad thought, you know, 3 dB, 4 or 5K from the entire kit. I'm hearing that as transients, like you mentioned in your description of the track. It's just got a lot of high-end smack and transient to it. And what Tom said as well, like just a little less smacky sounding, or had just a little less top end. If you took away the clarity and the punch of the drums and the transients of those drums, if that wasn't there, the rest of it would feel a little bit murky, where you said in your description, then everything seems to be not too clear. That's what I'm hearing as well, but it would be confusing in the mix to have drums that are this articulate and focused and just high def, I guess, it would kind of throw you off and make you think like, oh, the mix is clear, but it's not really. And that's because, it's giving you a false sense of security, I think, with some of the other elements in the mix. I think just a little cleanup in the mid range is all that you got to do. I don't think you're super far. I would, figure out the transients on the drums. You're going to be in a much better place if you figure that out first. And then the rest of it's just going to be a little cleanup on aisle 9. Sounds great though. And I love the track. Very cool. Totally fitting into the vibes for Halloween, which is neat. All right. Let's see. We did All Night, All Night. Ship of Fools, I believe, is our next one. Guys, if I've missed you, please let me know in the chat. We're getting down to the end of it here, I think. So this is Ship of Fools. Here we go. Hi, Def. Here's a cover of John Cale's Ship of Fools. Any and all feedback appreciated. That's feedback.
Ship of fools is coming in. Take me.
couple thoughts off the bat for me here. So in this section, I'm going to back up a couple bars, and the ride cymbal is closer to me than the snare and then the vibraphone, I want to say, that's happening in there. I got this new mic stand, and I just feel like it's always in my way. But I feel like the ride's just coming out a little bit in front, and the snare is a little bit recessed. And then on the kick drum, love the sound of it. Could probably use a touch, just a little bit of a tuck of a high pass, or just bringing the bottom of it down just a tiny hair. It feels a little bit like it's got some sub stuff that's just kind of rattling. Only other thing is in the vocals, I'm hearing a lot of lip smacking. Isotope RX D mouth click, default settings, just process it. It's perfect. It's awesome. I mean, you judge that for yourself, but sometimes the lip smacks and the you know, saliva noises and stuff pull me out of a mix the same way that like bad CGI in a movie does, where their whole goal is to suspend disbelief. And sometimes something like that will happen, and then you're like, oh yeah, I'm listening to a recording of a song instead of just kind of being in it. I agree with a ton of what Brad's saying here too. Brad's got some good comments on here. So check out Brad's stuff too. Here we go. In the side. Oh, sorry. I wanted to hear more of the bass guitar as well. That was a big one. The bass feels a little bit like it's back there to me, but it's cool and supportive of the melody and all that. Also, great playing. This is really good. I'll get you guys if I missed you. There in a minute. Great job. The only other thing I could think of is the kick drum may need a little bit of compression, not a lot, but for example, on the very last kick, it kind of jumps out, and there was like maybe one or two spots in there that it did that, but I wouldn't change the kick tone over that. It's not a big deal. And it felt really good to me. Just a couple balance things, seeing if you want the ride out that far. It's nice that it keeps the pulse, but it does feel in front of everything. And then, other than that, I got lost in the music and loved it. So job well done. Maybe it's done. I don't know. Is it done? Who knows? Okay, if I missed you, I'm going to try and get to you now. So Brad Heck over you, I believe, is next. And then I know that Juan, I think your username is listener number 28. I'll see if that's it. If not, let me know the name of the song. And somebody else said I missed them. Oh, yeah. Ennis Duman. Okay, so guys, don't be shy. If I missed you, it's not not intentional. It's just because I'm using the YouTube chat to figure out where I'm supposed to go next, and I get lost. So yeah, let's try and get to everybody who's here. So first one I said was going to be Brad Heck. He's just making some really great comments today. Heck of comments, we'll say. Making a heck of a commenter. Something. I'll just go back to listening to music. Let's see. Over You. I think that's the name of your song. Over You. Yep, I'll be over you. Brad Heck. Awesome. Here we go. Put this in HD. And he says, just finishing a new studio build inspired by you here in the mix tank. Nice. Try and level up my skill set. Use the designer who got my room nice and flat. Now I hear the stereo imaging stuff Mark and Tom have been trying to get me past. We put the studio band together in 2020 during COVID when all the touring shut down. Did a 6-song EP on a has-been studio guitarist, me. Okay. I hadn't mixed for 10 years. This is Pro Tools before I had switched to Harrison Mix Bus. I was terrified to mix the project after such a long break. It's like riding a bike. I'm sure. I don't know. I don't know if it is. I haven't had a break in a long time. But having let go for a while, I felt like a kid with a new toy box again. That's cool. That's inspiring. I'll have new stuff again soon. Having a place like this to grow certainly makes a big difference. Awesome. Congrats on that, Brad. Here we go. Earth. Brad, let me know in the comments if you have a stereo widener on this mix. Great job, Brad. That's fantastic. Amazing playing and everything, too. I'd say you hopped right back on the bike after not being on it for a while. Sounds fantastic. That's really cool. I'm still hearing a lot of stereo rapping on there. You said you do not have... Interesting. You don't have a stereo widener on there. Because I'm almost hearing the guitar rapping right around my head. It's six guitars on some doubles. Okay. Interesting. When I go to mono, I hear the stuff that would cancel from stereo, stuff like that too. Are you doing any phase tricks? You mentioned that there was something in Harrison, or is it Harrison mix bus? Yeah. Let me know. Yeah. Lenny cast your own percussion. Awesome. Yeah. The track is amazing. Yeah, it all sounds really good to me. I think what Tom was saying about wanting some more anchor in the middle of the stereo field, that's that center punch thing that I was talking about earlier. That was another reason I was wondering about the stereo widening, because the center feels a little soft to me as well. Are you going through a console or anything, too? Let me know in there. Double's doing it, probably. Yeah, that could be. No, I'm panning it all around. Cool. It's a Pro Tools mix, not... Okay, awesome. Interesting. I'm not sure what's causing what I was hearing, because it was on the solo guitar, too, that definitely wasn't doubled. But yeah, basically looking for more center punch. If you do, when you're working on it next, if you go into mono, see if things change drastically for you, like it's, you know, you're having that, what would happen from phase cancellation, 100% in the box. Any phase type things on the electric, like on the lead or anything, or like what kind of space are you using around it to do that? Could be like short delays or something. Let me know. Let me just listen to a little bit more too while you answer that. So I think that it is potentially like the stereo chorus thing. It's interesting because I definitely hear it rapping. I'm puzzled. MS processing. Yes, that's what we're looking for. Anything like MS processing. Let us know, Brad. I pan back in guitars one way, send to delay, then wet the delay. Probably too aggressive on those pans. I don't know. It feels pretty good. It's just, if it didn't have that sensation, that phasey sensation, I wouldn't say it was too wide at all. Troy Rose says, Mark, what would you think about using a live mixing board, something like an Allen and Heath, for example, only using the analog portion to do a hybrid mix? Bad idea. No, I don't think it's a bad idea. I would just try it and be really honest with yourself about the results. So the first thing to try that would answer it really quick instead of doing a whole mix. Actually, first thing to try, scratch the rest of what I said. Put some signal through it, like drums, guitars, vocals, and record it back into Pro Tools and level match the newly recorded stuff, and then A/B back to the original tracks, and be very honest with yourself about if there's something pleasing about that sound. So just running through the circuit, is it destroying the transients? Is it making things soft? Is it making things exciting? Is it adding a cool flavor to it? Or is it something that maybe it's not as great as you were hoping would come back in? And then the reason I said scratch the rest of what I said, if you like that format of mixing with your hands on a console, try doing a mix. Do a mix in the box and then do a mix on the board and see which one you were more inspired on. And also just make sure you're being honest with yourself at all times about the results that you're getting.
it's really easy to be fooled by, you know, if somebody threw a Neve in front of you, your brain has already decided that everything sounds better the second it goes through it, regardless if it's a broken Neve or not, right? So you have to be very honest and like really keep the excited, you know, audio geek part of us. Like I have it, everybody has it, I think. We have to keep that in check and make sure that we're always A-being and always asking, like, is this legitimately better and is it worth doing it, or should I just stay in the box? For me, I still like my my 2Bus Plus summing mixer, and I also have a at the studio that I track at, I have a 5059 over there. It's a Rupert Neve summing mixer. I still like what happens with those, but I'm definitely always like watching out to make sure that it's still helping and not doing something that, like, I think it just is doing that, you know, always making sure that it's improving things. Cool. Brad says none of that, no MS or anything. Did not miss my Harrison MR4. Oh, your console. Yeah. Nice. Yeah. Okay. Hope that that made sense on the console thing. So Brad, I'm not sure what's going on there. I don't know if it's a reverb or something that, that could be causing that. I would see if you could sort or check it out and try to like track it down. Let me listen a little. Yeah, it's on that melody guitar there. So whatever is happening on that guy. Awesome. I hope that that's somewhat of a use. Okay. And sorry, I can't like track that down to what I'm hearing there, Brad. But it is that like sensation of phasiness or like an MS processor or something that's like overpanned or chorus or phase stuff that's happening and over widening. But the playing is amazing and the rest of the mix, like, it sounds awesome. I hope that those comments were somewhat useful. Cool. And let's see. Oh, the mastering engineer may have done something. I sent it out to Andreas Mayo. That's possible. Yeah, I guess we'd have to hear the mix to know. Yeah. Awesome. That's a hidden double. Cool. Okay. Yeah, something's making it appear behind my head, which I'm very in tune with lately because I've been doing a lot of Atmos in here. And yeah, Tele in a 335. Awesome. Yeah, great. Troy, thanks so much. I've been thinking about, is it worth it? You've been looking at the 5059. Yeah, so the 5059 is really cool. I do love mine. The transformers in it do stuff to the transients, and you have to ask if that's a thing that you like when it does it. I do. I like it. I don't think it's necessary, and it didn't change my world upside down when I got it, though. So it's not like a magic bullet that'll, you know, change things, but it added a nice sort of like a cohesion to everything. That's the best way I can put it, and that's just exactly what you expect from a summing mixer with like crosstalk and distortion and all those things, plus all the transformers on input and output for each channel. It's like a lot of transformers in that thing, so it, you know, softens and kind of glues a little bit, but it's not a magic bullet. Okay, awesome, Brad. Yeah, congrats on the new room, that's super cool. Dave says those mastering guys love their MS toys. Hey ISO, good to see you. Okay, guys, I think I'm getting down to it. So if I've missed you, please let me know. I don't want to miss anybody if I can. We're pretty close on time. Let's see. Thomas Kramer, I missed you as well. Let me just see if there was somebody else that I missed. I missed this one is from Buffer Size, Ennis Duman. Let's see. Ennis Duman. There we go. Okay, let's check this out. HD. He says, I don't know, man. Just want to hear from different ears. All right. You can borrow mine. Here we go.
Yanlış bir yolu saptım.
The bottom of the kick drum's a little bit heavy compared to the rest of the mix on there. So high pass could help, but I think you'll need to do a little bit of cutting. Again, in that like 80 to 100 hertz range, it's just a monster. That's mostly because of our rooms and all that jazz. I won't go into it, but yeah, just a little bit of cleanup work down there. If you need something to hear that on, this is the kind of thing that would come out in the car test. So headphones, Apple AirPods would probably show this. The new, the pros or whatever they are. Okay, let's keep going. Reason I'm saying that too, on my speakers, which I know really well, the kick drum is sticking out in front of the kick, but, or in front of the snare drum, but only in the low frequencies. So that's why that bloom is happening. Here we go.
Kaybetmek çok kolay oldu. Yanlış bir yola saptım, hiç işaret yoktu.
Love the drum tones at the end too. I don't have a whole lot to say about this one other than the bottom end thing. It felt really good. I do agree with what Tom said about the parallel compression, using a gooey compressor, as he says, to just add a little bit of importance to the vocal. A gooey compressor for me for this would be probably like the Magic Death Eye. My head goes to Fairchild, but there's a little bit of brightness to Fairchild's too. So the darker 1176 from UA, the almost purplish one, would be cool. Not the purple from MC77. And I'm looking to see if I can show you a picture of my monitoring setup. I don't know if I have any good pictures on here. But if I find something, I shall send it. So, cool. Let's see. I'm trying to think if I have any other pictures anywhere. I can't really turn the camera around easily. So we'll see. But basically, Brad, my monitoring rig is a pair of Key 3s. And the rest of it is all Focal stuff. And then the room's just heavily treated and all that. I don't have a whole lot of comments other than what Tom put on here. I totally agree with those. And then the bottom end of the kick thing, I think once that's sorted out, it's going to be really good. I love the song. That was fantastic. Very cool. Yeah, great drummer too. And the tone of the drums at the end. Whoa. It's fantastic. Markaholic, yes, these videos are available on demand afterwards. This will be up on YouTube. Jeff, yes, I'll be at AES. And let's take a moment to talk about AES. Everybody who's still here. If you're going to AES, we are having our PureMixer hangout at the Flux party this year. So normally there's a PureMix hangout and then there's the Fabulous party at AES.
And because Flux has done a whole lot of upgrading and expansion over the last year, they now have enough room for us to merge the two events. So instead of having to do a Puremix separate event and then do the Fabulous Party on a different day, we can have everybody go to one, which is very cool, because the Fabulous Party is it's a bit of a legend at AES. It's insane. All of Flux gets taken over now, which is up to four floors and the roof. And all of the guys that are at AES that you see on Puremix teaching, if they're at AES, they typically come to the Fabulous Party. So it's just a fantastic hangout with all the mentors and everybody. There's all kinds of people there, gear manufacturers, and it's the giant party that happens on Thursday night at AES. So if you're a Puremixer and you're coming to AES, you will get a notification soon about how to sign up for that party to get on the list. But you guys are all invited. It's my favorite thing about AES is that party. It's very fun. Get to see all of my friends and all that stuff. So definitely, I'll be at AES. I'll be at the party, the Fabulous Party, on Thursday, October 26th. We will announce the time for the Puremixers. We may have you guys come a little bit ahead of the party so that you can just see the whole facility before it gets super crowded. Because once everybody shows up, it's a little tight in there, and you know, you're kind of walking around like this in between people. But it's a great party. You're going to enjoy it a lot. So if you guys are coming, definitely let me know too. It'd be great to hang out. So awesome. Six of one. I hope you're coming. We got to catch up. Awesome. Yeah, so SR1B is asking about a mixing contest. Last one was the warning, not quite a year ago. But yes, basically the SR1B, the holdup on mixing contests is we've transitioned to the new version of the site, which launched in January. And the mixing contest feature is taking longer than expected because we're trying to put some cool features into it. So the developers are working on it, and everybody is aware that it's something that everybody really loves about their Puremix membership, and we're working hard to get it back online. We're trying to put a little bit of energy into Mix Tank to hold everybody over as well in the meantime, but it's coming, and very sorry that it hasn't been up there. Multitracks are still available for download with the video. If we have the rights to release the truncated multitrack stems, we do that. And I believe that the Doja Cat song does have the stems cleared, so you guys will be able to download those on Friday. Yeah, and we'll see. Jeff, yes, let's meet. That's going to be awesome. Cool. Brad will be on the road, he says. Dang it. Skip the gig, Brad. You're playing in New York City. Cool. Guys, if I've missed anybody, I'm going to hang out for another minute or two. Please let me know if I've missed you, and we'll check the song. I don't want anybody to feel left out. I can hang for another minute here. Maybe we can do one more if I missed anything. So, guys, don't kill me if I missed you. Oh, Thomas Kramer. I know I missed that one. So if I missed anybody else besides Thomas Kramer, let me know. And we'll try and hit it. Okay, here we go. New project with 7-year-old son who's singing my cover production I made of the song. I'm not going to try to pronounce so I don't offend. By the German band. Let me know what you like and what you think I should improve. Thanks a lot in advance. Here we go.
Schwer, ohne dich zu leben, jeden Tag zu jeder Zeit einfach alles zu geben. Ich denk so oft zurück an das, was war, an jeden so geliebten vergangenen Tag.
Sorry, Thomas, I'm just going to pause for a second. This has sounded great so far, but I just wanted to say you guys are saying great show and thanks and all that. I wanted to say thank you to you guys because you hang out with me for this whole time. We've been on for, you know, 2 hours and 15 minutes or so, and I appreciate you guys hanging out. That's what makes it fun, and the chat room is amazing. So thank you guys for watching. All right, continuing on.
Ich stell mir vor, dass du zu mir stehst und jeden meiner Wege an meiner Seite gehst. Ich denke an so vieles, seitdem du nicht mehr bist, denn du hast mir gezeigt, wie wertvoll das Leben ist.
Okay, I got to pause again. Thomas, and anybody coming to AES, you have to meet Tom Foolery. Tom is Fab's assistant and an engineer at Flux, and our plant on Mixed Tank, who comments on everybody's stuff and gives amazing feedback that I kind of just echo a lot. But for Tom to say that the vocals are super cute, this is a thing, all right? Super cute is not something that Tom says. So he really thinks that these are super cute. All right, just putting that out there. Here we go.
Augenblick bist du mir wieder nah, wie an jeden so geliebten vergangenen Tag.
Thank you, Dave.
Es ist mein Wunsch, wieder Träume zu erlauben, ohne Reue nach vorn in eine Zukunft zu schauen. Ich sehe einen Sinn, für den du nicht mehr bist, denn du hast mir gezeigt,
awesome job, Thomas. Very cool. I really, again, am just going to echo everything that Tom says. So honestly, Tom's comments are fantastic. The only thing I would add to that is I feel the entire mix is over compressed a little bit. And that could be some of what Tom's saying in the kick drum, or he could just very specifically mean the kick drum compressor. But I feel like the whole thing is just being clamped a little bit and just kind of held down a little too much, like it could breathe just a hair a bit more. The vocals, your son, who did a stupendous job, just amazing, feel a little bit overcooked to me too, just in the compression area. However, it's hard to get a soft voice on top of a giant mix like this, so you'll need some of that. But I hope that that helps. Tom kind of nailed it there with all of his mid-range comments and some panning stuff and all of that too. So. And the mid-range comment specifically, getting more punch in the mid-range. Treble feels good. Some of the bass will be, you know, a little bit more enunciated once the compression's let go of a little bit on the bottom of that. So very cool. Okay. SR1B says, I'm seeing Michael Brower mixing this. Yeah, it'd be sweet. Yeah, that would, you know, if it's funny you say that, because the parallel compression thing that Michael does would allow the same kind of excitement without the squash feeling that I'm getting from the compressor. So yeah, something like that might actually feel pretty good. That's funny, SR. Okay, my last one for the day is Mick Drummer 9, The Ocean. Awesome. The scramble's on, Brandon. Nice. If you come, come to the Flux party so we can all hang. It'll be super fun. Okay, so Mick Drummer 9. Sweet. Mick Drummer 9. Thanks for hanging in there for me to get to that, Mick. The Ocean. Let's try it that way. There we go. All right, so submitting The Ocean again. Would appreciate feedback. Cheers, Mick. Here we go.
Then they went 1, 2, 3, 4.
There's something ultra bright on the lead vocal, way, way, way up top, that's like making my neighbor's dog bark on there. So I can't tell what it is. If there's like an exciter on there, like an aphex or something, or if there's just a lot going on up there. This does feel better though, Mick. I remember the last one, and this feels like a step in the right direction. So I'll keep listening. But there's something at the very top of the vocal that I'm listening to. And chat, maybe you can help me find it. Here we go.
Na 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 na
Yeah.
Mick, this is feeling really, really good. The guitars feel like they're hard pan, which is totally fine. This is more of a taste decision on this one. Given the song, the feel of the tracks, this feels kind of like a rehearsal tape to me kind of a thing. So I wouldn't go quite as wide on the panning personally. I would not to say it sounds like a demo, but I might like bring those things in and make it feel a little bit more cohesive, not quite as wide. That's basically what I would say. And then the only other thing I have is the top end of that vocal. So let's keep going from the end here. Yeah, same. The close tom mics are super wide, and they're they feel like tighter and louder than the rest of the kit does. So I kind of got like this recessed picture on the you know overhead snare kick, and then I've got direct sounding tom mics pan super wide left and right. They don't feel like a part of the kit, and then the guitars don't feel quite like a part of the band because they feel so wide in comparison to what's going on in the kit too. If you wanted to keep that width, a thing that I would do would probably be to, once again, add some of the room emulation stuff to it and just start putting some of the drum mics into that. Not to fill out the super wide part of the room and stretch the drum kit across the entire stereo field. I might like pan that in, you know, like 50 and 50 or something. But just make some more stuff happen between the absolute center of the record and the sides of it. Okay, let's see what the ending's like. Something high ringing there at the very end. Awesome, Mick. Yeah, I think you're getting super, super close. If you could find that thing in the vocals and maybe just try to get everybody glued a little bit more together, it's like it's feeling really, really good. Yeah, and definitely a big improvement from the last one. So hope that helps. Let's see. Would you tell Tomfoolery his other chatbot is spamming us here, please? Yes. It very well could be the ghost of Tomfoolery spamming us with the adult dating in the chat. Nobody click that. It would do bad things. Okay. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in today. If I've missed anybody, very, very sorry. We'll be back with Mixtank very shortly. Next week is going to be another episode of the Great Big Plugin Show. We're going to be looking at Vac Attack from Mixland Audio, sort of in honor of our video release this Friday from Jesse Ray Ernster, who is a big part of Mixland Audio. He released another new plugin called Vac Attack. I believe it's Vac Attack. It's a Vac Rack, but it's Vac Attack. Anyway, it's out on Plugin Alliance. So if you have a membership there, you can download it and try it out. And it's so far, it's pretty cool. I got to play with it a little bit on something, and I like the distortion character of it. So I remember that, and I'm going to dig in deeper, and we'll play with it on the plugin show. You guys can discover it with me. So cool. Joy was going to offer to be a mod. Nice. Great. Yeah, guys, thank you so much for hanging out this entire time. It's so great to see you guys, and thank you for coming back again. And AES Invite's going to be coming out pretty soon, and I hope to meet everybody in person there. So cool. Thank you guys very much for a great show, and I will see you on the next one. Bye.